I'm pretty awake today, everyone, and I'm excited to be here to talk to you about the respiratory system. The respiratory system is the system that allows our bodies to get rid of carbon dioxide waste and also to take in oxygen from our surroundings. So we have to have a way to carry out this gas exchange. This is the system that lets us do it. Let's jump right into it. We're going to look at the functional breakdown of the respiratory system. Functionally, there are sort of three different sets of things that are going on. There's the process of breathing, that's called ventilation. This is a mechanical process that causes air to move in and out of the lungs, but that's not where it ends. Once that happens, once that gas movement happens, there has to be an exchange between the air in the lungs and our blood. So there's this crossover that happens. Gas exchange takes place right there in the lungs. And then finally, once the gas is in the lungs, once the oxygen diffuses into the lungs, into the blood, then that blood gets carried out throughout the body, right through the circulatory system, out to different tissues that may need it. So at the tissue level, there's another type of gas exchange that happens where oxygen diffuses into the cells and carbon dioxide diffuses from the cells into the blood. So all of that, all three of those processes are considered part of the respiratory system. We've already talked about cellular respiration pretty early on in the semester. We covered that, so we won't be focusing on that process again here. You already know about it, so we're just mentioning it to complete our list right here. So we might talk about respiration at different locations. If someone talks about external respiration, what that's talking about is the type of gas exchange that happens in the lungs. And then internal respiration, that's referring to the gas exchange that happens in the tissues. So two different sets of gas exchanges going on. We'll be seeing that a little bit later on. So gas exchange, thinking back to early on in the semester, how does gas exchange happen? What is it that drives it to occur? It is driven by diffusion. It's a diffusive process. And in the lungs, what we have is oxygen moves down its concentration gradient. And since our bodies are typically kind of low in oxygen, we use oxygen up. That means that oxygen is driven inwards from the air into our bloodstream. Carbon dioxide goes down its concentration gradient, which causes it to move in just the opposite direction. So diffusion is a concept that does apply in this chapter too. Let's take a look at anatomically the respiratory system. We can divide the respiratory system up into a couple of different zones. One is called the conduction zone, and this is the zone that is just designed to move the air down to where the gas exchange can take place. We also have what's called the respiratory zone. That's also part of the respiratory system, but that's the site where actual gas exchange takes place, and that's down at the very bottom. So let's just follow the pathway here. Air is going to come down the trachea here. It will travel into the bronchus, the primary bronchus, and then the bronchioles. And then when it makes it down to the very end of the bronchioles, located at the ends, we've got these interesting structures. These are called alveoli. Alveoli is plural. Singular is alveolus. And we have a ton of these sacs at all of the ends of the bronchioles. Those alveoli are little air pockets, and that's the site where gas exchange can happen. There are a lot of capillaries that innervate, kind of wrap around the alveoli, and so that's the site where gas exchange happens. In order for this to take place, in order for us to get to accomplish a sufficient level of gas exchange, there have to be a lot of alveoli. We have a lot of these. And if we were to spread them all out into a flat surface, let's just think about the surface area that gas exchange can happen over. Okay, if we spread them all 300 million of them, that's a lot of alveoli, it's estimated that the surface area would be about 760 square feet. So you can think about that in terms of, I don't know, the square footage of your house or square footage of the room that you might be in. A typical bedroom is probably 10 feet by 10 feet, so that would be 100 square feet. Okay, thinking just within terms of the lungs, how many rooms is that? That's a lot of rooms. That's a lot of surface area. So it's a huge area over which gas exchange can happen. Each alveolus, we're going to zoom in on one just to take a look at it. Each one has some really key cells that do their job. Oh yeah, I forgot this picture is here. This is just a picture of showing that alveoli structure. So again, lots of surface area. It kind of looks like a sponge, and all of those little pockets are sites where gas exchange happens. Okay, let's take a look at one alveolus and check out the cells that are located here. So right here, we've got one alveolus. And the alveolus has a couple of key types of cells. We have type 1 alveolar cells, also called pneumocytes, like pneumonic pneumonia. Pneumocytes would be another way to refer to these cells. Type 1 alveolar cells, these line the walls of the alveolus. Notice how it's just a single cell layer thick, just one single layer of cells. What these cells do is provide that surface area for gas exchange to happen on. The other type of cell that is right over here is called a type 2 alveolar cell. These are the cells that are responsible for maintaining this interior surface. They keep it wet and they keep the water, keep it from building up. We don't want too much fluid down there in the alveolus. We want it to be just right. And the type 2 cells help to maintain that environment. There's something else in this picture that you've heard about before. Now here's a picture of it. Right here, what is this? This is labeled as a macrophage. This is part of the immune system. We've got alveolar macrophages that just reside in the alveoli, and they're there for a good reason, right? If you inhale air that is not pure, then there's always a chance that there might be some pathogens that make it down into the alveoli. And those macrophages are a good line of defense to have right there at that entry point. So they do a good job of maintaining the environment. Of course, there are some pathogens that are able to evade the defenses of that, respiratory illnesses. But in general, macrophages help to keep things clean right there inside of the alveolus. You can also see right here is a cross-section through a capillary. This is a capillary where blood would be flowing through, and there are red blood cells right there ready to take up the oxygen and deliver the carbon dioxide. So gas exchange, that diffusion of gas, does not have to go very far, right? That's a very thin wall that it has to travel through in order for that exchange to happen. So let's take a look at the path of air. The pathway that air takes in order to make it down here to the alveolus. The path of air goes something like this. When you breathe air in, so we're considering an inspiration, when you breathe air in, the air starts off in the nasal cavity, right? It goes in through your nose or mouth. And then from there, it goes into the pharynx. Right below the pharynx would be the larynx. That's where the voice box is at. This is a picture showing the voice box. You can see the vocal cords right there. The air continues on down to the trachea, and that's where this picture picks up. This is from our textbook. So the trachea right here, the trachea eventually splits into two paths. These are called the primary bronchi, or bronchus. Bronchus is singular, so we have two of them, bronchi. And after that, the bronchi split, right, kind of like a tree, splits off into lots of branches. These are called bronchioles. And at the ends of the bronchioles are where those alveoli are located at. So all of this, this whole upper section on this sort of flow chart, this is all just talking about the conducting zone, the conduction zone of the respiratory system. And then finally down here at the bottom, this is the respiratory zones where the gas exchange actually takes place. So it seems like this is the important area, right? Those alveoli, that's where gas exchange takes place. So that's really important, that's key. So it might kind of bring up the question, well, what's the point of all of this other stuff? Does it have a purpose other than just getting the gas to where it needs to go? It does have a purpose. So let's focus in on the conduction zone for just a minute. The conduction zone does a few key things. For one, it does transport the air. That's obviously very important so that gas exchange can take place. But it also, in the process, it also helps to get the air ready for optimal gas exchange to happen. So it warms the air as it comes into the body, humidifies it, filters it. So this is really key. The conduction zone is all lined by mucus, and mucus does a really good job of trapping particles that shouldn't go down to the alveoli. So the conduction zone acts to filter the air, clean it on its way down. And that mucus works in conjunction with cilia. So mucus is what traps the small particles, things that might be breathed inwards. But then it's the cilia that work to move those particles back out of the airways. So mucus traps it, and then we've got cilia on these cells that line the respiratory tract. There are cilia, and those cilia all beat together in kind of a coordinated fashion. They sort of move things along in one direction, back up the airways, and once it makes it up high enough, it can be cleared. Either it can be expectorated or it can be swallowed down into the digestive tract. And in any case, the end result is that we've kept those particles out of the bronchioles and alveoli. So that's important for maintaining the health of the respiratory system. There are some diseases that are very relevant to mention. We'll see some of these later on in the chapter, but let's just mention a couple of them right now. Cystic fibrosis. What happens in cystic fibrosis is that the mucus becomes really thick. That's due to the ion balance. There's a difference in the ion channels in individuals with cystic fibrosis. So this leads to really thick mucus, and it still works fine for trapping particles, but it's hard for the cilia to actually move those particles once they are trapped. So there tends to be this thick mucus buildup in the respiratory system in that case. The other one that we're going to mention right here is just kind of the consequences of smoking. So cigarette smoke, one of the things that it does is it damages the cilia. Over time, there get to be fewer and fewer cilia. So then, even if the mucus is fine, there's perhaps not as efficient clearance of particles. If the cilia don't work, then those particles are not going to be moved out of the respiratory system. So that's a problem as well. Finally, third key thing we're going to say about the conduction zone is just to draw attention to this. The conduction zone allows us to speak. It allows us to have a voice, allows the vocal cords to work. If airflow doesn't happen, then there is no way for speaking to take place. So this lecture is brought to you courtesy of the conduction zone.